Let me welcome you all to our service this morning, Tandragee Free Presbyterian Church. We give you a very warm welcome indeed, and especially if you're visiting with us, we give you a special welcome. And those tuning in through the social media, and we pray that the Lord will come and meet with us around the Word of God today. We're going to open our service by singing Psalm 1. What a lovely psalm it is, that man hath perfect blessedness, who walketh not astray in counsel of ungodly men, nor stands in sinners' way, nor sitteth in the scorner's chair, but placeth his delight upon God's law and meditate on his law day and night. We're going to stand as we sing this psalm. Amen. Let's all stand to sing. Let's all unite our hearts together in prayer. And as we come to pray, we want to pray for families in our congregation who have been bereaved this week. We think especially of our sister Hal Gibson, her husband Alan. As I'm sure you all know by now, Hal's dad passed away this week. So to Helen and Alan and the family, we sincerely sympathize with them, and we do pray that the Lord will sustain them even in these days. We want to remember the wider family circle as well, Mrs. Castles and Linda and David and their families, and also there are other families in the church connected to the Castles family, the Sturtett family circle and the Coulter family circle as well, and we want to remember these families, praying that the Lord will continue to give grace and help in their time of need. So let's remember these dear folk in our opening prayer. Loving Father in heaven, we bow humbly and reverently in your presence. In the name of the Lord Jesus, our Savior and our Redeemer, we come before thee pleading the merits of the precious blood. And O God, we do pray in our opening prayer Lord, for these families that have been bereaved. We thank Thee, Lord, for the grace that Thou hast given them over these past weeks. And we pray, Lord, that even this Lord's Day, that they might know in a very, very special way the nearness and the presence of the Lord with them. O God, we thank Thee, Lord, that at a time of bereavement we can cast our burden upon the Lord, and the Lord has promised to sustain us in our time of need. We thank Thee, Lord, that Thou art the God of all comfort. Therefore, we do pray for especially our sister Helen and all at this time, the Castles family. We just commit and commend them lovingly into Your care. We pray, Lord, that they might know the nearness of the Lord with them, that surrounding them is the arms of Christ. We praise Thee, Lord, that You've promised, Lord, to give help in time of need. And, O God, we pray that You would draw strangely near the families today. We thank Thee and we praise Thee, Lord, that we can come into Thy presence with assurance, knowing that when our loved one dies in Christ, that they're with Christ for all eternity, absent from the body, present with the Lord. We thank Thee, Lord, for saving David, and we just thank Thee that he's with the Lord today. But Lord, we recognize, Lord, that we're only human, and Lord, we miss our loved ones when they're gone, and we pray therefore that You would fill the vacant chair, that the Lord Jesus would draw strangely near, and oh God, that You would help us all to number our days and apply our hearts unto wisdom. For Lord, soon, maybe sooner than we think, Lord, the day of our death will come, for we're all going down the valley one by one, heading towards the setting of the sun. Oh God, may we all make that necessary preparation, if we haven't already made it, for the great eternity. We thank Thee for all the spiritual blessings in Christ Jesus. Oh God, how we thank Thee, praise Thee, that all who believe in Christ shall never die. We thank Thee, Lord, as far as the saint of God is concerned, precious in the sight of the Lord of the death of His saints. We thank Thee, Lord, that when the saints of God die, they go home to heaven, go home to glory, go home to be with their Savior for all eternity. We pray for those in our congregation, Lord, at this time who are still unsaved, still rejecting Thee, those in our families. O God, we pray that You would unite our families in Christ, even in these days, that You would speak to hearts, draw them to the Savior. We thank Thee for the mission this week. We thank Thee, Lord, for Your presence, for the Word of God that has gone forth in power. We pray, Lord, again this week, Lord, as the mission would continue, Lord, that You would be pleased to move, and Lord, that the tide might rise, that You'd bless those that will come to preach, and O God, that again they might know the infilling of God, the Holy Spirit, as they open up the precious Word of God. So undertake for us now, Lord, remember this service. We thank Thee, Lord, that we can come on the Lord's Day, Resurrection Day, and worship our Savior, the One who not only died, but the One who rose again, and the One who ever lives to make intercession for us. Lord, undertake and accept our worship this day. For it's in Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing another hymn. That's good singing. Hymn number 474. 464 it is. Simply trusting every day. Trusting through a stormy way. Even when my faith is small, trusting Jesus. That is all. If you're using the hymn book, it's 464. Amen. Let's all stand to sing, please.
Trusting Jesus, that is all. Trusting as the
Good to see you all in God's house today. We welcome you again in the Savior's precious name. Just a few announcements that I'd like to make at this part of our service. Do remember the gospel service tonight at 6:30 p.m. And I'll be here to preach the gospel tonight. And of course, the service is preceded by the half hour of prayer. And our sister Elizabeth Davison will be singing a couple of pieces tonight at the service. So remember the gospel service this evening. Then, of course, remember the mission. Tannochmore Orange Hall this evening at 8 o'clock. And certainly we have really enjoyed the meetings this week. And I believe we have known the Lord's presence night by night. And it's been encouraging to see so many folk coming in. If you haven't been yet, then we would encourage you to come along this week, and we know that your heart will be blessed indeed. This evening at the meeting, our brother Julian Patterson will be the preacher, and certainly we have enjoyed the Reverend Patterson's ministry this week, and he'll be preaching again tonight. Then Monday right through to Friday, each night at 8 p.m., and Monday and Tuesday night, God willing, our brother John Weir will be the preacher. And Wednesday night, the Reverend Abernethy will be preaching again. And then on Thursday and Friday night, the Reverend William McRae will be along to preach. So make an effort to get your friends and family in again under the sound of God's precious word. Now, in connection to this work here in Tandragain, Wednesday morning, Little Treasures will start again after the Easter break, and that's at 10 a.m. So I'd ask all the parents to please take note of that. And also on Wednesday evening at 7:30 p.m., the YM recommences again after the Easter break. So again, remember to pray for that work as it restarts again after the Easter break. On Friday, the Youth Fellowship and young people, this Friday night you're going to Lisburn, and the bus will be leaving the car park here at 7:15, so sharp. So do please take note of that. This is the last meeting before the young people break up for the summer. Though having said that, now on Saturday night, you're having a barbecue, an end-of-term barbecue here at the church at 7 p.m. And all young people are invited, welcomed along to that barbecue on Saturday night. Also, on Friday morning, we're having the last of our early morning prayer meetings at 7 a.m. So if you haven't got yet, then we would encourage you to remember. It's been encouraging to see those who have come, and the spirit of prayer each Friday morning has blessed our own hearts and souls. And this is the last one at this time of the early morning prayer meetings. Then next Lord's Day, the Sunday school at 10:15, the Bible classes at 10:30, the services 11:30 in the morning and 6:30 p.m. in the evening, preceded by the half hour of prayer. Next Sunday night, our brother Mr. Stephen Crawford will be here to preach. I've been asked to go and give my testimony in Dungannon. So do remember to pray for our brother Stephen as he comes along to preach the Word of God. Also, next Sunday night is the Lord's Table at the end of the service, and the Reverend Baxter will be in charge of the Lord's Table next Sunday evening, and the Rainey family will be here to sing at the gospel service next Sunday night. There's another announcement here concerning the after-school Bible clubs. I think all the details and the dates have been up on the screen here for you, but I just want to say that our brother Philip Harton has worked with many of the local primary schools during the past few years, and in total there are Bible clubs planned for 5 of those schools in May and in June. Now this is a great opportunity to get the gospel to many of the children in our community. Now there's a list in the hall today, and we would like you to put your name down in that list if you're able to help. The times and all are there, of course. Now, it would be ideal if one male and one female helper could help out at each of these Bible clubs, at least one male and one female, if that is possible. And I'd ask you to pray about this matter, and if you can help in any way, please put your name on the sheet as soon as possible as Philip plans for these outreach efforts. So do take these Bible clubs, after school Bible clubs, upon your heart, and if you can help, then please put your name on the sheet ASAP. We need to know as soon as possible if you're able to help. Now, I think that's all the announcements. We're going to sing another hymn, and the offering is going to be taken up again for the Lord's work. It's 462 in the hymn book, 462. 'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take Him at His word, just to rest upon His promise, just to know, thus saith the Lord. 462, and we'll keep our seats as we sing. Please turn in the Bible this morning to Exodus chapter 17, Exodus 17. And we're going to read a few verses at the end of this chapter. I'm sure familiar verses to most of us, but let us read down this account again, and we pray that the Lord will write His word upon our hearts this morning. Exodus chapter 17 and the verse 8. Then came Amalek and fought with Israel in Rephidim. And Moses said unto Joshua, choose us out men, and go out, fight with Amalek. Tomorrow I will stand on the top of the hill with the rod of God in mine hand. So Joshua did as Moses had said to him, and fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And it came to pass, when Moses held up his hand, that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hand, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy. And they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side, and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady unto the going down of the sun. And Joshua discomforted Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword. And the Lord said unto Moses, write this for a memorial in a book, and rehearse it in the ears of Joshua, for I will utterly put out the remembrance of Amalek from under heaven. And Moses built an altar and called the name of it Jehovah Nissi. For he said, because the Lord hath sworn that the Lord will have war with Amalek from generation to generation. Amen. We know the Lord will bless the reading of His word to all of our hearts. And with God's word open before us, let us bow in a wee word of prayer and ask the Lord for His help as we come to consider God's truth this morning. Father in heaven, we thank Thee again for Thy precious word. And we pray, Lord, that You would indeed bless the reading of Thy word. We thank Thee, Lord, that is the entrance of Thy word that giveth light. And we pray, Lord, as we come to consider Thy truth just now, Lord, that we might know the infilling of the Holy Spirit. And, O God, help us only to say those things that are pleasing to Thee. Bless each head bowed in Your presence. We pray, Lord, that You would encourage Your saints and strengthen our faith even in these days. And, O God, that You would help us to look unto Jesus, who is the author and the finisher of our faith. And we pray, Lord, that even today that You would speak to all of our hearts. We thank Thee and we praise Thee for the precious Word of God, that it's quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. O God, we just pray now, emptiest of self, and Lord, come and meet with us. For it's in Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. As you read through the history of the children of Israel as they come out of Egyptian bondage and pass through the wilderness into the promised land, there are four characters that are prominent in that period of Israel's history. They are Moses, Aaron, Joshua, and Caleb. And there's no doubt that these four men are the main personalities in Israel's history at this time. All the events surrounding the children of Israel from the time of the great Exodus until the entering into the promised land are centered around these four individuals. However, even in this period of Israel's history, there are many lesser known characters who were just as important as they served the Lord as were Moses, Aaron, Joshua, and Caleb. One such man was Hur of the tribe of Judah. There are four different men in the Bible mentioned by this name, Hur. But the Hur that we want to consider this morning was the companion of Moses and Aaron. He was the man who helped prop up the arms of Moses during the fierce battle that the children of Israel had with the Amalekites. Jewish tradition says that Hur, this man that's mentioned here in Exodus chapter 17, was the husband of Miriam, the sister of Moses. However, we cannot be sure of this fact. But one thing we are sure, when we study this character, it is evident from what the Bible teaches us about him that he was a great man of God, and he was one who God used in a mighty way. As the children of Israel came out of Egyptian bondage, went through the wilderness towards the promised land. And no doubt, he was a great help to Moses and Aaron. And of course, before we end the message this morning, we'll see that here in this chapter, Exodus chapter 17. Now, it's interesting to note that every time Hur is mentioned in the Bible, he's either serving the Lord or associated with those who are serving the Lord. And that in itself is a wonderful testimony for any child of God. Therefore, as we come to consider this lesser known character in the Bible, I want us to see what the Word of God teaches us about him. The message in the main, of course, is to God's people, but I pray that the Lord will take his word and write it upon all of our hearts, because there's no doubt that there's a message here for each and every one of us. It goes without saying, of course, that this man, Hur, was saved, and he loved the Lord. No record of his conversion in the Bible. When we're introduced to him, he's serving the Lord. But there's no doubt that there was a day in his life when he was gloriously converted and when he trusted the God of Israel and was saved by the grace of God. And again, let me emphasize, if you're not saved in the church today, then that's your greatest need. As we've been finding out in the gospel mission this week, and as we will find out in the week that is to come, the greatest need of every man, woman, and child in God's house today is to be sure that they're heaven-bound and redeemed by the precious blood of the Lamb. But what do we learn here about this man, Hur? Well, first of all, I want you to notice the company that he kept. The company that he kept. Look what we read there in verse 10 of Exodus chapter 17. So Joshua did as Moses had said to him and fought with Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. And then I want you to turn over for a moment to chapter 24 of the book of Exodus. And I want you to take a look at what it says in verse 13 and 14. And notice the different people who are named here alongside Hur. It says in verse 13, and Moses rose up and his minister Joshua, and Moses went up into the mount of God, and he said unto the elders, notice the elders as well, tarry ye here for us until we come again unto you, and behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them. Notice the men that are mentioned here. Moses is mentioned, Aaron is mentioned, Joshua is mentioned, and also the elders of Israel are mentioned. Now, all of these men were godly men. Aaron was the high priest who was appointed by God. Joshua at this time was the minister of Moses, who later was to take over from Moses, leading the children of Israel into the promised land. Moses, of course, was perhaps the greatest man of God that ever walked upon this earth, apart from the Lord Jesus Christ. And the elders of Israel were men appointed by God to carry out that office. And they too, as we have emphasized, were godly men. Now, these were the type of men that Hur wanted to keep company with throughout his life. That's what I want to emphasize here. Very simple point. But these were godly men who were the true servants of the Lord. These were the type of men that Hur wanted to keep company with. Is it not interesting to notice that? Is it not an interesting fact to observe? The only references that speak directly about Hur's life on this earth emphasize the company that he kept. Now, as I have emphasized there, it's only a little point. But I believe it's important, very, very important, when we come to consider the life of the Christian. You know, child of God, it is so important that you and I seek out the company of God's people at work, at school, at university. Now, that does not mean that we ignore our unsaved loved ones or friends or workmates. How can we ignore them? If we want to win them to Christ, we must be in their company in order to speak to them about the Savior. However, let me emphasize this from this simple point. There is no company like the company of God's people. No company like the company of God's people. We sang that Psalm 1 this morning. Let me read you the first two verses again. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And of course, the psalm is emphasizing to the child of God the importance of not walking in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standing in the way of sinners, nor sitting in the seat of the scornful. In other words, it is emphasizing, I believe, the importance of seeking out godly company. What did the psalmist say? He said this, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. And isn't it wonderful to be able to come out to God's house and to meet with God's people and to worship with the people of God? Isn't it wonderful to come in to the prayer meeting on a Tuesday evening and to have fellowship and times of prayer with the people of God? Oh, I would say it to us all, but especially the young people, maybe not long saved, seek out the company of the redeemed. Make sure that your best friends are those who are saved and redeemed for time and for eternity. It was Paul in Hebrews who said, not forsaking the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as ye see the day approaching, not forsaking the assembling of yourselves together. And there, of course, Paul was emphasizing the importance of God's people meeting together as a band of believers to worship together, and to hear the Word of God, but not only to worship together, but to have times of fellowship together. And what a blessing it is to be in the company of the people of God. It's a simple point, but isn't it amazing that every time you read of Hur in the Bible, this man, this lesser known character in the Bible, he's in the company of other godly men. He's in the company of the redeemed. Oh, I pray that you and I, child of God, will always desire the company of God's people. And as I said, especially young people. Young people, seek out the company of the redeemed. And especially when you go to universities and get away from home, make sure that you're found in the company of God's people. But notice something else. Turn back again to Exodus chapter 17. There's something else here I want you to notice about Hur. Secondly, notice the cooperation that he gave. Take a look at what it says in verses 11 and 12 again of Exodus 17. It came to pass when Moses held up his hands that Israel prevailed. And when he let down his hands, Amalek prevailed. But Moses' hands were heavy, and they took a stone and put it under him, and he sat thereon. And Aaron and Hur stayed up his hands, the one on the one side and the other on the other side, and his hands were steady until the going down of the sun. Now Moses here, of course, is in the midst of the battle. He has just sent Joshua with the armies of Israel to fight against Amalek. And as Joshua goes out to the battle to fight against the enemies of God, Moses goes up to the top of the mount, and lifting up his hands and his arms, he intercedes to the Lord on the behalf of his people in the battle who were fighting in the valley below. Now, there's no doubt, as we have already emphasized, Moses was the man that God had chosen and that God had anointed to lead the children of Israel and to guide the children of Israel out of Egypt throughout the wilderness journeys. And here we have Moses again in the prominent position, going forward, holding up his hands and interceding on the behalf of the people. However, and I want you to see this, the hands of Moses grew weary, and when he let down his hands, Amalek begins to prevail against the children of Israel in the valley below. It was just at that moment that Aaron and Hur, who were with Moses on the top of the mountain, make Moses sit down on a stone, and they uplift the hands of Moses and hold his hands up until the battle is won. Until the battle is won. Now, without the cooperation of Hur and Aaron, of course, Joshua and the children of Israel would have been defeated. Amalek would have won the day. Therefore, we can see the vital part that Hur played in the great victory that was won. Now, no doubt, Joshua was hailed as a hero that day as he fought in the battle below. No doubt, Joshua was uplifted that day because of the victory that was won. But the victory was won because of the men who were in the mountain praying and interceding. And more importantly, interceding was successful because Hur and Aaron uplifted the hands of Moses as he interceded. What's the lesson here? Child of God, the lesson is very simple. There's times even the minister's hands can grow weary in the battle. There's times that even the elders can grow weary in the battle. There's times when those in the front line of the battle can grow weary. And that's why it is so important for each and every one of God's people to continually uphold them around the throne of grace and help them to lift up their hands as they intercede for the work of God and for the blessing of God to fall. Child of God, if there are not those who will uphold the hands of the preacher as he preaches the word of God, then the word can just come to nothing. We need to work together, and I think that is the truth here that's being taught in this passage of Scripture. We need men like Moses to lead and to stand on the top of the mountain, but we also need men like Hur to uphold the hands of God's servants as they serve. We need one another. I believe that's what the passage of Scripture is teaching. We need men like Joshua who will fight in the battle, But we need men like Moses and Aaron and Hur who will continue to intercede on the behalf of the work of God. We need to work together, just as Nehemiah needed the cooperation of all his servants as he built the wall in the book of Nehemiah. Just as the sick man in Mark chapter 2 needed the cooperation of his four friends to bring him to Jesus. Just as Jonathan in 1 Samuel chapter 14 needed the cooperation of his armor bearer as he went into the battle. So the servants of God need the cooperation of every saint of God, called of God in this house, to continually remember the work of God around the throne of grace. And here we have a simple example of one of the lesser known characters in the Bible. We all have heard of Moses. We all have heard of Joshua. We all have heard of Aaron. We all have heard of Caleb. And we could go through all the different main characters in this book. But I wonder how many of you have ever heard of Hur, and how many of you have ever studied what he has done and what he did for the Lord. He was just as important. Listen to me. Hur was just as important that day when the battle was going on as Moses was. He was just as important that day as Joshua was. He was important. And child of God, whatever small work you think you might do in this church, you're important. You're important. You're important to the preacher and the minister. You're important to the elders. You're important to the session and the committee. You're important. Oh, I pray that we might realize that as we go forward in the work of God, that we must go forward together. It's emphasizing unity in the work of God. I want you to keep your hand in Exodus chapter 17 for a moment and turn over to a very familiar psalm. It's Psalm 133. And here we see this truth emphasized, this truth of working together, this truth of unity in the church of Jesus Christ, this truth of helping one another in the work of God. Look at Psalm 133 and verse 1. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of his garments, as the dew of Hermon and as the dew that descended upon the mountain of Zion. For there were, in the place of unity, in the place where God's people are working together, there the Lord commanded the blessing, even life forevermore. God will not bless a divided house. God will not bless a divided house. But God will bless a home, a church, a denomination that is united together. What if Hur had fallen out with Aaron? And when Moses' hands fell, he said, I'm not going to hold up. I don't want to work with that boy. They had to work together. And because they worked together, the blessing of God was seen in a mighty, unique way. Something else. Turn back to Exodus chapter. In fact, turn over to Exodus chapter 24 again. The third thing I want you to notice about Hur is this. I want you to consider the counsel he was instructed with. The counsel he was instructed with. Take a look at verses 13 and 14. We have read them already, but let's read them again. And Moses rose up, and his minister Joshua, and Moses went up into the mount of God, and he said unto the elders, tarry ye here with us until we come again unto you, and behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. If any man, here's the counsel he was entrusted with, if any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them. As Moses went up into the mount to speak to God, he left Aaron and Hur with the responsibility of settling disputes among the children of Israel during his absence. Now, what a great privilege for any man to receive, to be instructed with such responsibility. Now, this was a step up for Hur. He was a man that could be entrusted with greater responsibility because he had been faithful to God's work and God's service in Exodus chapter 17. Now he is being given more responsibility. That's the point that I want you to see. And child of God, again, is a very simple point. There is a great lesson here for you and me. If we are faithful to God in the little things, God will use us in the greater things. If we are faithful with a little responsibility, then God will give us greater responsibility. And I believe that truth can be seen in the life of Hur, and can be seen here in Exodus chapter 24 very, very simply. You know, there's a wonderful text of Scripture found in Luke's chapter 19, and it's verse 17, and this is what it says. And he said unto him, "Well, thou good servant, because thou hast been faithful in a little matter, have thou authority over 10 cities. You know, child of God, when we're faithful in the little things, sometimes people don't want to do the little things. That's the problem. But it's good to start off with the little things. And when we're faithful in those little things, and we do them as unto the Lord, then the Lord perhaps will give us the privilege of doing even greater things for Him. But here we have this man, Hur, this little unknown character in the Bible here, the lesser known character here among these mighty men. And he's doing what the Lord wants him to do. And you know, that's all we have to do for the Lord, what the Lord wants us to do. Should it just be sitting with children in a children's meeting? Should it just be bringing children to a meeting? Should it just be giving out a gospel tract or giving out an invitation? Those are little things, but God sees them. And there's no knowing, child of God, if you're faithful in the little things in this house, no knowing how the Lord will set His hand upon you and raise you up to do even greater things for Him in the days that lie ahead. And again, while speaking to all of us, I would say to the young people, get involved in the work of God here in the church. The Lord has called you here, you're here, and the Lord wants to use you in His service. And if you're faithful in doing the little things, I have no doubt that in the days that lie ahead, that the Lord will raise you up, and the Lord will use you even in a far, far greater way. Notice something else here about Hur. These are just simple points from the life of this character here. But take a look with me there at Exodus chapter 38 for a moment. Exodus 38. I want you to notice, fourthly, I want you to consider the continual blessing that his family enjoyed. Now, we read here in this portion of Scripture about another perhaps lesser known character in the Bible, and he goes by the name of Bezalel. Now, I don't know whether you've ever read the history of Bezalel in the Bible or not, but you should. That's why it's good not only to read the New Testament and the book of Psalms, it's good to read the Old Testament as well, because in the Old Testament you read about these characters, especially these lesser known characters. But you'll notice that God takes these characters up and uses them in a most unique way. And this man, Bezalel, was used in a most unique way. Take a look at verse 22 of Exodus chapter 38. It says, "And Bezalel, the son of Uri, the son of Hur, of the tribe of Judah, made all that the Lord commanded Moses. He made all the furniture for the temple. And he did it unto the Lord. Indeed, the Bible tells us that Bezalel was a man who was filled with the Holy Ghost. And if you take the time to read Exodus chapter 31 and the verse 1 and 2, you will see that he was a unique character. But who was Bezalel? Well, he was the grandson of Hur. That's who he was. Bezalel was Hur's grandson, and he was used by God to make the different items in the tabernacle. This was a very important task, as we have already pointed out, which was done and accomplished by this individual. Therefore, and this is the point I want to make here, Hur saw not only his grandson become a child of God, but he also saw him become a servant of God. Not only did Bezalel get saved, and that, of course, is a truth that we need to emphasize as well, an important point, of course, but then the Lord took him up and used him in this service in the tabernacle, making the furniture for the tabernacle. But he was Hur's grandson. You know, I'm reminded of how God blessed the family of Lois in the Bible. You remember who Lois was? In 2 Timothy 1 verse 5, we read about Lois. First, God saved Lois, and then he saved her daughter Eunice, and then he saved her grandson. And we all know who her grandson was. Her grandson, of course, was Timothy, and how Timothy was greatly used of God in the ministry. You know, is it any wonder the Bible says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And here we have an example, two examples indeed, one in the Old Testament and one in the New Testament, of how the Lord blessed the families of those who were faithful to him and sought to serve him, and how their children and their grandchildren were used in a mighty way in the work of God. That's why it's good. I know it's not an easy thing sometimes to read the genealogies in the Bible. Sometimes we're apt to skip across the genealogies. But you know, they're there for a purpose. And I believe one of the reasons why the genealogies are put in the Bible is to show us how the Lord blesses families. And the Lord does bless families. And thank God today for all the different families in our congregation. And isn't it wonderful that there are many in the church here today, and not only is the first generation saved, but the second generation is saved, and the third generations are saved. And I know, of course, in all of our families, we have those who are not saved, and we're praying for them. And that's what we need to continually do. But child of God, let me encourage you. You're praying for children and grandchildren. You continue to pray for them and to hold them up around the throne of grace, because what the Lord has done in your life, he can do in their lives. Praise the Lord. And that's why we should continue to remember to seek the face of the Lord for them and pray for them earnestly. Here we have Hur. And the Lord is blessing him, and the Lord is using him. And even to the second and the third generation, the Lord is taking up his offspring and using them in the work of God and in the service of Christ. And that's, of course, what we want to see for all of our children and our grandchildren. We want not only to see them saved, but we want to see them used in the work of God. And let's pray even to that end. Oh, child of God, I think the main lesson from the life of Hur is this, that we do what we can for the Lord. We do what we can for the Lord. And we do it faithfully, and we do it with all our hearts and with all our souls. And if we do, no matter what sphere of service we're doing for Christ, whether it's working in the kitchen, whether it's in the pulpit, whether it's cleaning out the church, whether it's making someone a cup of tea, whatever we do for the Lord, we do it with all our hearts, with all our souls, and with all our minds, and the Lord will bless our service. And that's why I would encourage the Sunday school teachers and the children's workers and the Bible class leaders and the youth workers and those who go out to pick up the children, bring them in, no matter what you're doing for the Lord, those who work in the kitchen, to continue to serve the Lord. You may not be known outside this congregation. You may not be known as a Moses or an Aaron or a Joshua or a Caleb, but sure, if we're only a her, it's not worth it all serving the Lord. But let us go forward together, serving the Lord with all our hearts, souls, and mind. And the Lord will bless, as He has blessed down through the years, this congregation. And He'll bless our families if we keep faithful to Him. Oh, I pray that the Lord in these days would work in all of our hearts and draw us all closer to Him. Because as we often say, we have only one life, it'll soon be passed, and only what's done for the Lord Jesus Christ will last. I pray that God will bless these few thoughts to your hearts even today. Let's bow in a wee word of prayer. Father in heaven, we thank Thee and we praise Thee this morning for the Word of God. We thank Thee, Lord, for these lessons and truths that are emphasized concerning this man, her. O God, how we thank Thee and praise Thee that all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. Lord, may we be those who will seek out the company of God's people. May we be those, Lord, who will do what we can to serve the Lord. Even, Lord, if it's only lifting up the hand and the arms of the preacher. Oh God, may we be those that will seek to win our families to Christ. And may we have the joy of seeing them like her had the joy of seeing his grandson serve the Lord. May we have that joy, Lord, in our day and generation, to see our loved ones, our family, our children walk with God. Lord, that's our desire today. Lord, we pray for our children, our grandchildren, our families. We don't pray, Lord, that You'll make them rich as far as the wealth of this world is concerned. We don't pray that, Lord, You'll make them popular. But, Lord, we pray that You'll save them and use them in Your service. For Lord, that's the only thing that counts at the end of a life. What we have done for Jesus will last. And that's all that will last, Lord. Everything else will be wood, hay, and stubble, and it'll be burned in the fire, but only what's done for Christ. Oh God, may that truth burn within all of our hearts. And Lord, that in this congregation, Lord, that You would bless us with unity, that we might go forward and help one another in the work and in the service of Christ. Lord, undertake for us now. We just thank Thee, Lord, for Thy presence with us. We pray, Lord, that You'll separate us in Thy love. And Lord, that You'll keep Your good hand upon us the rest of this day. Bless the service tonight. Remember the mission this week. Come, Lord, and reach down and save many precious souls. For it's in Jesus' precious name we ask it. Amen. Amen.